Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lisa Brown, and I'm a professor of international banking studies here. I have glasses, which I can read, but I can't see you. So I have this dilemma of who I see, my paper idea. At the moment, the preference is taken. This afternoon, we are very happy to welcome you all here, a particularly warm welcome to the Center School students. On the Global Poverty and Inclusive Development Program. Thank you all for being here. And of course, a very warm welcome also to a number of special guests. Let me start in the South. The Center for Planning, the Umbrella and Upgrading Center, indeed, remains right above the bed. And a very guest from the South, Pierre Smith, from Durban, South Africa. I still think that we have a guest in the audience and come back to our speakers at this juncture later. Now, we are very happy indeed to be able to host the 47th Kavichinsky Lecture, which is a very interesting, very exciting lecture, which is sponsored by the EU. In conjunction. And we're very happy to be able to focus here on urban issues for a number of reasons. If you look at development studies, there has been far too little attention given to urban issues in development. It's been quite a long-term focus on rural development, integrated rural development, fertile states, etc. But for urban areas which are growing in terms of their importance of population at a global level, in terms of inequalities which are harbored within them, and their strategic effects on the regions around them, there's been far too little attention. So we're very happy to be able to focus in this lecture on such issues. A second reason is that, in fact, at the University of Amsterdam, this urban issues is one of the focal points of the research that we do here. That applies not only to the department where we are, where urban research is being done, say within several of our research groups, including that of our own projects in inclusive development, but also at the wider faculty level, interfaculty level, under the banner of the Center for Urban Studies. And in a minute, I will give the word to Jan Wigman, who is the director there. Who is leading this bundling of research on urban issues?
Thank you, Lisa. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here and to the university as a part of the Center for Urban Studies to be asked this talk. When you were at the Center for Urban Studies at the University of Amsterdam in the city of Amsterdam, you had to be identified with the city of Amsterdam. What's happened to that now? And most people would say, at the same time, we're really very interested in making comparisons that looking at the urban world as a whole in a comparative fashion. I'm very happy within the Center for Urban Studies. Program is that closely entwined with what we do. My own work is in the research of the and the one so very personal, many other places. The question of fairness and the certainty is such a powerful one, such a very important one that I'm going to look forward to this lecture. And after it's we can have the discussion about it. If any of you have any questions about the center, feel free to have a chance to socialize with afterwards. Suffice it to say that it's a research priority area of the university. So I'm grateful for the university of in selecting the center of the 15 key areas of research. And we share into the future, this will continue to be really important. really good help for now and how to do it.
Thank you, Jan. Now I'm going to introduce a second Jan, namely Jan Krzyzinski, who is representative of the UNDP regional office in Bratislava, who has a background in communications and development issues and has worked for a number of years, particularly focusing on the organization of the Indigenous Director. So we're very happy to have you here this afternoon. I think one of the interesting perspectives that we discussed at lunch that you're bringing in also is the role of the new European member states actually as donors, moving from recipients to donors in the same international development aid discussion. So very welcome indeed here. Very, thank you very much indeed for allowing us to have this lecture.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to thank the speaker, Professor Powell, for accepting the invitation for the recent chapter. So I'd like to thank the university once again for hosting it. Indeed, we launched this initiative quite a long time ago already with the European Commission. So the European Commission will be beginning by the universities back here in the University of Amsterdam. It was started in 2009 with the Australian lectures and several development or development-related topics that are at several hands now. In order to trigger a debate on certain topics, and as one of our speakers put it very nicely, to challenge the conventional wisdom on development. And this is very much needed. Probably not only for you, but also for us as the big development agencies like UNDP or the European Commission, to put a bit of critical thinking to the mainstream of development and also in the area of organization. It was also very much related to Richard Kapuscinski himself, who you might know he was a journalist and writer in the late 2007, covered extensively the development practice, and he was very often challenging these conventional wisdoms that we shared throughout the world, and certainly he focused very much on people actually, on human development, on people's abilities, but also limits, some dreams, and so on. And this is what I would also be part of lectures that we have, if we talk about cities, if we talk about human rights damages, and so on. In the end, it is about people and their needs in terms of development. I'm very happy to also to welcome the online audience because we have these lectures questions. I also like to encourage you, but also the online audience to participate not only in terms of asking questions here, but if you could comment on Twitter questions on Twitter using the hashtag.
Thank you indeed. Now let me turn to our speaker of this afternoon, Susan Parnell. She is, and I'm very happy to say that as a geographer myself, an urban geographer in the Department of Environmental and Geographical Sciences at the University of Cape Town at the African Centre for Cities, a centre which is very well known for its exciting research, but also its links to practice and to particularly new forms of practice, which we look forward to hearing about. Before her appointment, Bill, she taught in Johannesburg as well as in the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. Although she started out as an urban historical researcher, I think since 1994, with the social transformation happening in South Africa, she's drawn very much to contemporary issues of urban policy, democracy, poverty reduction, and environmental justice. I think that's informed the choice of her focus for this afternoon. Let me say no more about this, but to give you the floor, please. A hearty welcome to Sam.
Thank you.
Thank you. doing compassion. It's not like many of you are born into the household of one of the worst performing human circumstances. Your parents are literally, but as an infant, I began having to play piano from a grade 2 to 4. That's a very, very different difference. Okay. And so there was an immense difference between the cities, between the little ones. We also have a form of education and education.
Do you mean to be able to
more talking about the topic, we're not talking about the politics. And the key is at the moment, I don't want to remind you that what they decided are power movements, shapes the relationship of governments to perhaps the most destruction of wealth that is possible. But what it has to do is to stay on the single scale public here.
Because you see, to look at how
increase the tax revenue is bringing some challenges in general sales tax. So the tax revenue is absolutely crucial. So without expanding the capital base, we cannot begin to redistribute more.
Taxation. At least, especially the double-sided ourselves, we're going to be operating and controlling. Yeah? And that's not in the distribution. That's different. That's how people do it, because they have to. I feel like Mark told me here about the kind of difference between the poor and the able to extract it from them. You know, how our corporations will back to use our help with the challenges. I'm not talking about the kind of participatory processes that are talk, and do that's what we're talking about. What I'm trying to do is to say there are things that we do, can we do them better? Should we do them better? Can we really have a particular part of it? So what are the things that are happening in the past? Can I say anything? Can we say anything else? Thank you. Why do I have to be in this sort of place? It doesn't mean
Thank you.
I'm going to ask this to be a crucial
person.
Some of these issues. and it's hard to actually break even. So he said, yeah, no, the practical question is, I'm totally practical with this depression that I'm in. And there is this idea that you also very effectively suggested that we can sort of like poverty into place with the better environment. Right? We can produce creative communities, as some people call it. We can build walls that people can't get through. The issue that puts in charge is with the better environment that we don't need to build things. We don't need to clean things. You can build a corridor that can afford people to go through it. You can do a wall and you can absolutely do random to go through it. Yeah, and so with planning is the need in the program. So that's okay, but that's a long way. There are elements of planning to the physical environment where that goes beyond. As to me, when I was here, what can be done? So all the examples, I guess that we can learn from that we have principles of planning, built physical environment, where we look towards and place. That's it. So let me say it without pressure.
Thank you. We have to like to take a couple of microphones today because we don't have to really raise the cloud to the microphone, so maybe we'll just take a moment to I have a tendency to kind of
it's so sacred. And I think it's clear that actually we need to talk about meditation, it's the whole body and mind. So, and I think that's true here. And I think cities by their nature are making meditation, they're beautiful art, they aren't clean, and they sometimes it's fair, sometimes it's not fair, So I think that's true. Actually, I think that sometimes it is useful for us to go back and say, where is it important not to have a relativist position? And I think that's one time I thought it was like multi-provision from the Islamic branch of it. How can we, in the 21st century, have millions upon billions of people living in cities without water? That's not right. So the outlook is that we just have to be collecting unambiguous and draw some lines. And then on the question of can spaces be positive spaces, I have to point out that I'm a bit of a hobby architect. I would love to be a landscape architect or urban design. I hate to have the job, but to imagine the capacity to build beautiful places that will make people happy, that will enable people to meet, that will improve their lives, through manipulation of materials and spaces.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think that's the people that's going to be the best of the time. I'm going to go to the next slide.
I'm going to go to the next slide.
I think that the shop owner does not make what it is. So that's not making Thank you. I'm going to go to the next slide. Thank you.
I'm going to